So now I would like to hand over the call to Varuna Mataji to introduce today's speaker. So Mataji, please take over the call.
Hare Krishna. Firstly, I would like to thank you all for joining me today. I would just introduce about Vrindavan Prabhu. Actually, it has already been said, but I will just read that again. His Grace Vrindavan Prabhuji is a postgraduate of Commerce and Business Management from India, but he gave up his high-paying job to serve humanity. He first came in contact with ISKCON in 1974, and understanding that spreading the true message of Bhagavad Gita is the highest welfare activity, he joined as a full-time preacher in 1985. Prabhuji is a senior disciple of His Holiness Radhana Swami Maharaj. Under his guidance, he has opened many preaching centers in ISKCON and developed them into successful congregational preaching centers. He is also well known for his 7-day Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam discourses, which were attended by thousands of people. Recently, he has written a book on Sant Tukaram in Marathi, and in just 1 year, thousands of copies have already been sold. This book is also available in English. At present, Prabhuji stays with his family in Pune, India. He travels all over India, America, and Europe every year preaching the message of Bhagavad Gita. Also, Prabhuji has taken great initiative in having many temples in Maharashtra, and he is well known for his strong preaching and his wonderful kirtan. So now, it's great pleasure. I will just hand over the call to Prabhuji. Thank you so much.
Om Ajnanati Nirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuronmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Guruve Namaha. Sri Chaitanya Manohishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prestaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pacharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshitarine. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Thank you all for giving me this opportunity to talk on Chaitanya Charitamrita. So, in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila 9-82, there is a description that Krishnadas Kaviraj is narrating how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to Pandharpur. So, I am told that next 3 days in this session, we are going to talk about Sant Tukaram. So, many people, they may be wondering how Sant Tukaram is related to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, here is a description by Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, and then we will read Srila Prabhupada's purport, and then we will come to know how Tukaram is related to Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya. So, Chaitanya Charitamrita writes about that there are many verses, but I am going to read just one verse, the first one. तथा है ते पंडरपुरे ऐला गौरचंद्र विठल ठाकुर देखी पाइला आनंद. From there, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Pandharpur, where he happily saw the temple of Vithal Thakur, performed by Sri Prabhupada. The city of Pandharpur is situated on the river Bhima. It is said that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu initiated Tukaram when he visited Pandharpur, and thus Tukaram became his disciple. Tukaram Acharya became very famous in the Maharashtra province, and he spread the Sankirtan movement all over the province. The Sankirtan party belonging to Tukaram is still very popular in Bombay and throughout the province of Maharashtra. Tukaram's book is known as Abhanga. His Sankirtan party exactly resembles the Gaudiya Vaishnava Sankirtan parties, for they chant the holy name of the Lord with Mridanga and Kartal. The Lord Vithal they mentioned in this verse is a form of Lord Vishnu with two hands. He is Narayan. So this shows how Tukaram is related to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, which is a disciple. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Pandharpur, when we started from Jagannath Puri to go to South India, we had two missions. One is to find out where his brother Vishwarup, since he took sannyas externally, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu didn't know where he's gone. And internally, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to spread this holy name of the Lord all over South India. So therefore, he started. And when he comes to Pandharpur, in Pandharpur, he stayed for 11 days. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu on South India tour, when he went to South India in Srirangam, he stayed for 4 months. And the next highest is Pandharpur. He stayed there for 11 days. Every day he will take a bath in the river Chandrabhaga, and then he will go to temple, dance and ecstasy. And whoever sees him, they will all dance with him and chant, and there will be katha like that. Stayed for 11 days. So many things happened during those 11 days. Srila Prabhupada mentioned that he initiated Tukaram. And also he found out that Vishwarup, his brother, has taken, he left, he took samadhi in Pandharpur. And also Nityanand Prabhu, he took initiation in Pandharpur from Lakshmipati Tirtha. So this is how this Pandharpur is related to Gaudiya Vaishnava. So today and tomorrow and day after, we will talk about Tukaram. What is his contribution to Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya? And how he, what was his life, and how he spread this holy name with his own example. And we'll try to dive into his life, and also we'll see what are his teachings along with. So Tukaram's life can be described in his own Abhangas. In his Abhangas, whenever I say Abhanga, that means his own poem. So why he appeared in this world is explained by himself. So he says, to protect religious principles, to shatter the non-Vedic conclusion, to sow the seed of the holy name, this is our only mission. So he says that he appeared to protect the religious principles and oppose the Vedic conclusion, that is the Pakhanda or what is not Vedic. And most important, to sow the seed of the holy name, and that is our mission. So that is how he appeared, to spread the holy name. And in another Abhanga, he explains that he has appeared from Vaikuntha. And the purpose of his appearance is to spread the knowledge which is given by Vyasadeva. But because of Kaliyuga...
Can you be a little louder?
So because of Kaliyuga, people have forgotten the religious principles. And therefore, he has come to remind them of the principles given by Vyasadeva. So in this way, Tukaram came from Vaikuntha to this material world. And then he speaks about his identity, of what is he in Vaikuntha Loka. So he says that we are close friends of Lord Hari. Playfully jump on each other's back. Both of us have transcendental bodies, so we are never separated from each other. When Sri Hari takes rest, we massage his lotus feet. When Sri Hari conquers Lanka, we were with him as monkey soldiers. When he was herding cows in Vrindavan, we wandered with him as a coward friend. So Tukaram says, I am the constant companion. And therefore, he has come here to remind Lord of everybody. And in another Abhanga, he says, I have come to spread the holy name many times. So this is not the first time he has come. So he is here to spread the holy name. So that is how Tukaram is seen in the scriptures. He himself talks about how he came into this world. Now, so before that, before Tukaram's appearance, he tells about his family lineage. So about 7 generations before, there was a devotee of Panduranga or Krishna whose name was Vishwambar. He is the great-great-great-grandfather of Tukaram. the seventh generation. So this Vishwambar, he was a very much a pure devotee of the Lord. Even though they were all money lenders and has a grocery shop, but that was not their main business. Their main business was to chant the holy name and hear katha and serve the sadhus who are coming to them and arrange festivals and spread Krishna consciousness. So this was their main business. So this Vishwambar, when he was small, his mother, Amai, told him to go to Pandharpur because he was staying in Dehu. And he told that Panduranga Vithala is our Lord and Master. And he is the maintainer not only of our family, he is also the maintainer of the whole world. So I want you to go to Pandharpur and take darshan of Panduranga. So he offered obeisances to mother because he said that you have shown me a right path. But that is the duty of father and mother to show the right path to their children. So he was thankful that mother has showed him the right path. And he thanked her, he offered obeisances. And immediately he left for Pandharpur. So when he came on the outskirts of Pandharpur, he saw hundreds of devotees. They had flags on their shoulder, and they had mrudangas and kartals, and they were all dressed as the Vaishnavas. And they were happily and joyfully dancing and chanting the holy name of the Lord. And they were walking to Pandharpur. So he was happy to join them, and he came to Pandharpur and with them. He took a bath in Chandrabhaga, and then he went to take darshan. So he visited Pandharpur, and the first sight, he was attracted to the deity of Pandharpur, and he lost his heart to that deity. And so he went there. Every day he will take darshan. He went for 1 or 2 days, but his heart was so captivated by the beauty of Pandharpur Vithala that his lotus feet, he don't wanted to leave them. So therefore, he stayed there for 5 days. But still, he was not happy. See, and then the fifth day, he told Panduranga, he said, I don't want to leave Pandharpur. Then he was praying like that, and the Lord told him, you know, he appears in his heart and tells him that I am everywhere. So even if you go to Dehu, you will be able to see me. And then he says, no, but my heart is attracted to you. Even though you are everywhere, but I am seeing you right here, so I don't want to leave you. He said then, when you chant the holy name of my holy name, wherever you chant, I will appear there. And I am always there in my holy name. So you should go back to Dehu. So then reluctantly, he left for Dehu. But his heart left, heart was in Pandharpur. He could never separate it. So as he came to his own village, Dehu, which is about 30 miles from Pune city in India, Maharashtra. That was his birthplace, and he also stayed there. So then he started thinking about Panduranga, and he was so immersed in thinking of Panduranga that whole day he was chanting the name of Krishna. So all the village people, they started criticizing him. You know, he said he just went to visit Panduranga, and since he has come back, he is not in this world. He just always chants, and he always praising the Lord, and he is always dancing like a madman. So then he said, people are talking like this, but he couldn't, he tolerated, because when you take the Krishna consciousness, you have to ignore and tolerate what ordinary people say, because they cannot understand what bhakti is. So therefore, he said, okay, you know, whatever they have to say. So he started spending more time in practicing and preaching Krishna consciousness. So after that, every Ekadashi, he used to walk
about still it is about 300 kilometers every Ekadashi. For every Ekadashi he will go to Pandharpur and take darshan, and in this way he spent his life. So when he became a little old, he was not able to perform this activity of physically going to Pandharpur. So he was just lamenting, so it's my unfortunate situation, physically I cannot go, but I cannot leave Panduranga. So he was weeping and crying because he cannot physically go. So in that state, one time he slept. And in a dream, Panduranga, he came to him and he told that, I'm so pleased with your devotional service. For many, many years, you are coming, walking, and for my darshan. And if you cannot come, I will come to you. See, this is how Krishna reciprocates. Whenever we have physically capable, we render service, but we cannot, then Krishna comes and accepts our service in whatever form, like chanting or hearing katha. That's also Krishna. So therefore, Krishna told Vishwambar that if you cannot come, then I will come. So like that, he said, tomorrow, as soon as you get up, you go to the mango groves on the outskirts of Dehu village, and you will find me there. So next day morning, all people, all the Vaishnavas, they all got up, and Vishwarupada already, Vishwambar has already told them that Krishna appeared in my dream. So some people ridiculed him, you know, whatever happens in, whatever you see in dream is not always the reality. Said sometimes you dream that you have a mountain of gold, but it's not a reality. Sometimes you see tiger roaring or so many things you see in a dream, but that's not a reality. So if Krishna is coming in your dream, so it's not a reality. It's just, you know, it's a dream. So you should not take so much seriously. But some people said, see, Vishwambar, you know, he always chants the name of Krishna, so Vitala. So therefore, because he's always thinking about Krishna, so he feels that that's why he saw Krishna in his dream. Because whatever you think whole day, sometimes you see that in the night. And some people said, oh, no, why you are ridiculing him, why you are criticizing him? Let us go and see, you know. If he's saying, let us go and see. So these, some of these Vaishnavas, they believed in whatever Vishwambar said. And when they started, they came with all the instruments of for cutting plants and trees and grass. So they came, and when they came, they saw a beautiful tulsi grove. And there is a tilak and scented so many things to offer to the Lord, and it's the tulsi. And so they thought, Vishwambara thought, oh, this is the place where the Lord should be. So they started the digging ground, and at that time they heard from sky that I don't want you to use any instruments to dig the ground. I want with your hands you dig the ground and you will find me. So that's how Vishwambara and all these Vaishnavas, they started digging the ground. And finally, they saw the beautiful deity of Vitthala, who is not different than Krishna. And aside that, there was another deity of Rukmini. So they found this Vitthala Rukmini in the Devu. Then they took both deities out. And then they took to the very wonderful, beautiful, and very clean river in Raini. And they washed that deity there. Then they brought the deity in their house, and they did welcoming deity installation ceremony. And Vishwambar invited the whole village, not only whole village, many surrounding villages. Tens and thousands of people came, and they witnessed the installation of this beautiful Vitthala Rukmini deity. And that's how these Vitthala Rukmini have come to Dehu. So if you go to India, if you go to Pune, it's very close. You can take darshan of this Vitthala Rukmini deity, which are considered non-different than Pandharpur Vitthala Rukmini deity. So many of these Maharashtrian devotees, workers, if they cannot go to Pandharpur, they go and take darshan of this Vitthalarupin deity because they have appeared for Vishwambar so that he can render service to them. So in this way, the deity came there, and since then the worship of this Vitthalarupini is going on. So now Vishwambar, he was almost old man, and he was about to leave this world. So he called his two sons, Hari and Mukunda, and he said that this Vitthala is our only property, and it is my request, it is my desire that when I am gone, you should take care of Vitthala Rukmini, do whatever I have taught you, do whatever I have told you to do, take care of this deity, have festivals, invite sadhus and Vaishnavas and Brahmanas, feed them, and have Harikatha, Harikartan. So through that, you can preach this message of Krishna consciousness. And after giving this advice, after ordering this to Hari and Mukunda, Vishwambar left this world chanting the name of Krishna. After that, Hari and Mukunda, they came to age, and when they wanted to, they were serving the deities, but because they were not so much attached to the deities, they thought, if we have to materially prosper, economically if you have to prosper, Dehu is a small village, you're not going to earn money there. So you're not going to earn any prestige there, because it's a very small place. So they decided to go to Pune to work. And they decided to leave Dehu and go to Pune to earn some money and earn some prestige. By that time, Vishwambar's wife, Amai, their mother, was reminding them, see, these Vitthala Rukmini, they are our Lord and Master. And wherever they are, I want to stay. And they came here to listening to your father's prayer. And the father have promised them, yeah, actually what happened, when Vishwarup was leaving his body, his Vishnu came and asked him, if you have any desire left, he said that make sure that in my family, the deity, this Vitthala Rukmini will be worshipped like I have started in my family for all the time to come. So Vitthala promised them that I will make sure that all of your descendants will worship me. They will spread this Krishna consciousness as you desire. Not only that, seventh generation from you, there will be a pure devotee born in your family who will not only worship this deity, he will spread my holy name all over the world through his poems and through his devotion and through his life, encouraging everybody to take shelter of Krishna. So, and then he left. So this Vishwambar's mother, Vishwambar's wife, so Amai, Harimukunda's mother, she told that, see, this is a promise given to your father. Your father gave this promise to Vitthala. So you have to stay here and worship this Vitthala and Rukmini. And then Hari and Mukunda, they were reluctant. They said, no, God is everywhere. Krishna is everywhere. So we can worship them in cities also. I don't have to stay here. And then they said, we'll give this worship to some local people and then we'll go. So mother was saying, no, please don't do this. Your father have promised Krishna that your care will be taken in the family. So it is not good. We should not leave. But they were very stubborn, so they decided to leave. And they came to Pune, in the city. But their mother and Vishwambar's wife, Amai, was not happy. But she was what she can do. In Vedic tradition, mother ladies don't stay alone, women don't stay alone. So she had to go and live with the two kids, Hari and Mukunda. So she also left with them, and all three of them, and also at that time Hari was married and Mukunda was married. So five of them, they all went to stay in Pune. So when they came to Pune, at that time, they were looking for material prosperity. And they got the material prosperity what they were expecting, and they got the position. They were serving under the Muslim king, and they were getting big money according to that time and prestige. But Amai was not happy. Amai was always feeling that we have done wrong thing. So Vitthala came in her dream and told that with both of your son and your daughters-in-law, you should return to Dehu and serve Panduranga. And that is good for you and that is good for them. So this Amai, she told this to Hari and Mukunda. He said that Vitthala came in my dream and he wants me to come back and take care of him. So Hari and Mukunda, they say, oh, your mother, you have become very old. So sometimes when you get old, you see dreams. And that is why you are seeing this thing. So dreams are not never become true. So she just, she said, but please, I also am not happy here. I want to go back. But she couldn't come alone. Then after some days, again Panduranga came in a dream. He said, I told you you should go back. You're still here. And she was saying that, but my both sons are not listening. What can I do? It was all going in a dream. Then Panduranga says, you should try to convince your son. So she said, okay. So when she woke up, she went to Hari and Mukunda again. And she said, see, please, let us go. Panduranga is Vitthala Rukmini. They are waiting for us there. And because we have left their service and come here, although you are having material prosperity, but still, that is not everything. Real life is spiritual life. And you have given up that. And now you have come and stayed here in the city. So this is not good. Vitthala is not happy. And I am also not happy. And therefore, we should all go back. And they said, no, it's not going to happen. So we have decided to stay here. The third time, Vitthala came, but this time was very angry. So he said to Amai, he said, today, before noon, you should leave this place and go to Pune. Otherwise, great danger is going to fall on you, and your both sons will be killed, and your whole village will be destroyed. So and then Panduranga disappeared. So in the morning when Amai, Vishwambhara's wife, and Hari and Mukunda's mother woke up, he told Hari and Mukunda, he said, today Panduranga was very angry. And he said, if we don't go back, Panduranga is real upset. And you will be killed and the whole village will be destroyed. He said, how? And by that time, they were in the good position in the army. So he said, mother, these dreams never become true. Why you are all worried about it? Don't worry, nothing will happen. He said, in the afternoon, as Krishna had told, that they were having lunch and the plate was ready and they were sitting and they were about to eat. Their door was knocked. And when they opened the door, there was a messenger from the king. And he said, king has ordered to leave in whatever position you are because the enemy has attacked. And we have to face. So see, they have to leave. They were about to eat, but they couldn't even eat. And they have to go. See, this is a material world. Anytime, any danger can come. We should not, see, Krishna gives us so many warnings. Especially, all these indications are from our body we get. And like when we start getting, teeth starts falling, and ears we cannot hear, or hairs become white or they fall off, we cannot see with your eyes, you know, the taste goes away, the body becomes fragile. So this is a notice, this is an advanced indication by Krishna that you should take your life seriously. So we try to do so many things, you know, try to fix the body over again, and then now I think we are all happy in this world. So this is how we neglect Krishna's warning. And therefore, we have to face a cruel death at the time of leaving this body. So we should be serious when Krishna gives us this call of with many instructions or many indications that now we have to leave this world. So this Hari and Mukunda, they didn't take it so seriously. And they went for the war. Both of them were killed. And the whole village was destroyed. So Amai was left with his two daughter-in-laws. So in that, Hari's wife was pregnant because he was older. And younger was Mukunda. So Mukunda's wife, according to tradition at that time, she decided to go Sati. Nobody forced her. This is love for husband. So she just jumped on the pyre of burning pyre of her husband, and she gave up her body. And Hari's wife and her son and Amai, three of them, they came back to Pandharpur and they started staying there. So in this, Hari's son was Vitala. So in that tradition, in the seventh generation, there was Bulluba, and it was this Bulluba is coming in the seventh generation, who is Tukaram's father. So this Bulluba, he was taking care of the whole business and money lending business. They were very rich. It is said that in today's calculation, their monthly income was 75 lakh rupees at that time. 7 million rupees every month at that time. Just imagine how rich they were. So, but that was not their main opulence. Their main opulence was bhakti. Because the whole life, not only this Tukaram ancestors' family's life, but the whole village's surrounding, their main center of worship was Vitthala and Rukmini. So everything they do is for the pleasure of Vitthala and Rukmini. The whole village, not only one family, the whole village was just living because that Vitthala Rukmini's temple is there. Even now, it's a very small place, and you see, everybody stays there, is related to that temple, somehow or the other. So, this Bulluba, he had as a humble Vaishnava, so he was desiring that they should have, you know, as Chanakya Pandit says, putrahinam gruham shunyam. So without son or daughter, the household life is empty and not complete. So this Bulluba, having a desire that he should have son. So he was praying, and Vitthala appeared in his dream. And he says, I really heard your prayers. Then tell me what kind of son or daughter you want. And Bulluba is saying, I want son who is a pure devotee, and also by his example, he will preach Krishna consciousness to the whole world. And he should be attached to the holy name and the Vaishnava Seva and the worship of the deity. Then Panduranga said, many people ask so many benedictions, they also want to have, but nobody asks this kind of benediction. But because you are pure in heart, I will give you this benediction. A pure devotee will be born to you soon. So Vitthala disappears and they have their first son, he from the very beginning of his life, he is very detached, and he is very devotional, has no interest in anything material. So his name is Kavji. He appears. And the second is Tukaram. So at that time, Vitthala is having a conference in Vaikuntha. And he explains to many devotees sitting with him. They are having Ishta Goshti. And then he said, it's the time now. I have to fulfill a desire of one pure devotee of mine in the material world. So he has asked me a son who can preach Krishna consciousness and the pure devotee of the Lord. So who is ready to go to material world and do this service for me? So Tukaram at that time, he raises his hand. He said, I will go and I will do this service for you. So this Tukaram appears as the son of Vallobha. And as a tradition, Vallobha takes Tukaram and offers it at the lotus feet of Krishna, of Vitthala. And it is mentioned that the name Tukaram was given to him by Rukmini, because Tukaram is, that means there is no comparison. Tuka means not Tuka. He said there is no comparison to his devotion to Ram or devotion to Krishna. So therefore his name is Tukaram. So this Tukaram, and then there is another brother, his name is Kanuba. So these three brothers were there, Savji, Tukaram and Kanuba. So as they started growing, and Vallobha became old, so he saw that he is becoming old. It is becoming old is a sign that means you have to take seriously Krishna consciousness. You see, King Dasharath, he saw one white hair on his head, and he decided that he will leave the kingdom and give it to Ram and go on forest. So this is the indication that when our hair starts becoming white. So nowadays it is not practical because our hairs become white when we are even 15 or 20 years. But at least, around Prabhupada says, at least on the 50, we should be preparing to leave this world by in consciousness. Even though physically we are strong and everything, but should be preparing for the leaving this world. So Vallobha was that kind of, see, he has millions of rupees property, and he was very much respected. He is a pure devotee of the Lord. He was doing the service of Vaishnavas and serving sadhus and hearing katha. But still, he knew that this material world is a place of suffering, and we should get out of this world as early as possible. So he was praying to the Lord, and then he decided, now I should retire completely from my business. So he called his older son, Savji, and he told him that now, elder son, take the responsibility of father's job. So I want you to take the responsibility. So at that time, according to that system of that time, Savji was also married at a very young age. Then Savji said, I have no interest in material earning of money. I have come here to earn spiritual credit, not for material benefit. So I don't feel any interest I'm not good at doing this business, so I don't want to take part in it. So Vallobha, he was very happy that he saw his Savji's sons, whatever the renunciation he had, and therefore he didn't force him. He appreciated his desire to renounce the world and go. And Savji told that it is the duty of the son to take care of his father and mother. So as long as you are here, I will take care of you. And when both of you leave, I'm going to leave this place and go to some holy place, and I will reside there, and I will try to perfect my life in Krishna consciousness. So Savji, he denied, but in his denial, there was a purpose. He wanted to take spiritual life seriously. And he was young at that time, just married. So, see, father also, he appreciated his spiritual inclination, and he didn't force him. So then he called Tukaram at that time. Tukaram was also married. He had one wife. So he told Tukaram that Savji is not interested in doing any service, any job, I mean, our continuing our business. So now the next one is you. And I want you to take part in this business and grow this business. And as long as this is our business, and also with that, we practicing Krishna consciousness is our main tradition. So Tukaram, he took this great responsibility, and he started taking care of his father's business. And then Tukaram was every day, he do everything what was supposed to do in the shop, and he'll take care of his family business. And at the same time, in the evenings and morning, he'll be going to the temple and worshipping, chanting the names, and spreading Krishna consciousness. So this was going on for some time. It didn't go, when everything goes well, people think this will go on forever. But that doesn't happen in the material world, because Krishna says this material world is dukhalayam or shashvatam. Even if everything goes well today, there is no guarantee that everything will go afterwards or tomorrow or even after 1 year. So Tukaram knew this because he was reading Bhagavad Gita, he was reading Bhagavatam, and he knew what his bhakti is. So he knew that. So what happened, it all started with his father. His father left this world, and then in 6 months, Tukaram's mother left world. And both of these, they left this world. Then, as Savji, his older brother, because there is no father, there is no mother now, so because he has problems, as long as he is there, he'll take care and then he'll leave. So as soon as they left, Savji also left the whole, left the world. And because Savji left, his wife, in separation, he also left the world. So within 1 year, all these things, family members are gone. So he was a little disheartened. It's not easy thing to take when 4 family members leave within the time of span of 1 year. And after that, there is no rain, so it was a drought. So because there is no rain, there is no food grains that year. So they were lending, they were grocery shop, they had Tukaram had. So they were lending money as well as selling groceries. So because there is no rain, those people who have taken loan from them, they could not return. And second thing, because there is no rain, people had no crop. So whatever grocery was available, everyone was selling it at high price, but Tukaram didn't raise its price. You see, in this wherever there is a scarcity of anything in this world, immediately the price of that produce or product jumps like 10 times more, because these businessmen, they try to take advantage of scarcity, and they try to make more money. So this exploitative mentality is there in this world. But Tukaram was not like that. Tukaram was, he was so humble and so compassionate and so loving. even though people didn't give any money, still he will give them grain. Not at higher price, at a regular price what he was selling. Everybody else was making money, but Tukaram was don't want it to cheat, don't want it to exploit people, because he had that kind of a heart of a Vaishnava. So he didn't charge more money, or he didn't ask for more money. So they were taking grains and everything with, you know, everybody was coming. And not only that, people didn't pay any money back because they didn't have any food grain. They don't have anything to sell. So Tukaram was losing on both ends. That one is his giving grains, and also nobody was paying money back. So this way, the first year went. And the second year was more dangerous. There was no rain. So it is continuously the second year there is no rain. So the situation became more grave. People have absolutely no money, and people have no grains. So Tukaram felt compassion, and he was giving his, whatever he has, he was giving it. He didn't care whether they'll give money or not, but he thought, whatever Krishna has given to me is meant for everybody. So therefore, he said, I cannot eat when somebody else is hungry in my village. I cannot eat and enjoy if somebody else is suffering surrounding me. So that was his mood as a Vaishnava. So he gave the grains to all the people in this village. And also, people were not returning money back, and the interest was increasing. But Tukaram was not charging more interest, and people were not paying money back. He said, don't worry, you can pay me whenever you get grains. This was happened second year. And during that second year, his first wife, he also died. And his first son, he also died. So because of some disease, and Tukaram had to, according to that, so this happened all 3 years. So Tukaram was saying that whatever Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, I am experiencing, I am realizing how this material world is temporary. See, just imagine 3 years ago he was a millennial, and in 3 years he lost everything. He lost his parents, he lost his business, he lost his money. And third year it so happened he didn't have any food to eat. But just imagine his devotion. He never blamed Krishna for that. So, in fact, he thanked, like in the mood of Kunti, he thanked Krishna. He said, my wife died and you made me free from Maya. And he said, my business, I lost my business. And he said, because I lost my business, I have all the time to chant your holy name. And therefore, it is good that I lost my business. Anybody will say that in this material world? Nobody will say that. But this was his mood. He was he thanked Krishna for losing his wife, losing his business, and he developed Vairagya. And after developing Vairagya, he became indifferent to this world. Now he was practically on the road, and all day he will just chant the name of Krishna. He don't have anything, and he will just meditate. So at that time, he because all the people were criticizing him, so he started doing some business. There was no success because he was not money-minded person. He was not money-minded businessman. So the businessmen were telling him, because you are mad after Krishna, you will never be successful in business. He said, business means you have to cheat people, otherwise you cannot earn money. But Tukaram says, I cannot do that. Because I cannot, I see all living entities are, you know, they part and parcel of Krishna. So if I cheat them, it is cheating Krishna. So I will not be able to do that. So they said, you will never be able to be a business successful businessman. But Tukaram didn't mind that, because he knew Krishna consciousness is the main purpose of life. So not earning money or earning prestige. So he didn't fall prey to the advice of his fellow business people in the society, in the Dihu. So he kept his life very simple, and he kept his life very devotional. So in spite of all these things, they were having kirtans and bhajans and a service in the temple, and he was all day, he will just roam around the village and just do whatever people say. He was so humble, he never thought that he is a big person. He thought he is always a servant of everybody. So he will go and serve all living entities. Everybody, whoever calls him, he will do anything, whether he is devotee or non-devotee. He didn't think about it. If somebody is devotee or somebody is non-devotee. Anybody calls him, hey Tukya, do this, and he will do that. And if somebody will call him, hey Tukya, bring this for me, he will do that. And not only that, he was taking care of all the pilgrimages. He didn't have anything, any food in his home to eat. But any pilgrimage comes to Devo on the way to Pandharpur, he'll take care of them. He will give them place to stay. He will try to make some arrangement for them. He will take care of all the visitors and sadhus. He will feed even the dogs and cows in Devo. So in this way, he was totally dedicated to the service, thinking that these are all Krishna's devotees and I am their servant. So in this way, he was chanting, and he was taking care of all these other things. So he didn't have any business left. So his wife, she used to be very upset. She said, everything is lost, but you are supposed to work. You are supposed to maintain your family. And he used to say, I don't see only my wife and my kids is my family. My family is this whole world. And Krishna's family is my family. So Krishna is taking care of everybody. He says there are 8,400,000 species of life. Krishna is taking care of everybody. And therefore, we should have faith in whatever Krishna is giving, is whatever Krishna is doing with our life, is just to bring close to us, close to Him. So therefore, he didn't lament, even though he was losing everything in his life. So I will stop here today, and tomorrow we'll continue from here. Now I have 5 minutes left to 12. If anybody have questions in whatever we talk today, so there are so many things we are going to hear about him tomorrow and day after. So whatever we talk today, if you have anybody questions, please I'm open to answer. Thank you. Is anybody there still?
Yeah, Hare Krishna, Guruji, Dandavat Pranam, all Guru Sushila Prabhupada. This is Amit from Atlanta. So, Guruji, I have just one question. So, you said that Lord Vishnu, they had a East Coast at the spiritual world, and they were discussing like who gonna go to a material world and spread Krishna consciousness. So you said then Tukaram raised his hand. I'm just wondering, so Tukaram's spiritual identity is Tukaram only or something else in a spiritual world?
I can't say anything about that, but he's a devotee of the Lord. Maybe they have different names in the spiritual world. Prabhupada, somebody asked him about Prabhupada, what is our spiritual identity? He said, when you go there, you will find out. So we should not guess about anything.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, you mentioned.
No, spiritual identity is there. That's why first one of the Abhangas I mentioned before too. He said, I was there when Krishna incarnated as Ram and I was a monkey. And in his Abhanga, he said that he was Angada. And then he says, when Krishna appeared, then he was a coward boy. That's what he says.
Okay. Thank you, Praveen.
Hari Bol.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Prabhu, it was a very beautiful class. I have this very silly question. At what age Vishwambar had gone to take darshan of Vitthal at Pandharpur?
He was very young. I believe he was 16 or something. Yeah, very young.
Okay, and without even any guru, he had got that love for Vitthal Dev?
That is not mentioned in the scripture, but it's mother told him to go to Pandharpur, and Krishna told him to chant the name. So this is okay. In the scripture also there are many exceptions that Krishna personally guides, so they don't need any guru. But Krishna personally guided him, it happens with pure devotees. So at least externally, it is not mentioned anywhere, because his history comes very small, because it's in relation with Krishna that he is there. He may have guru, but it is not mentioned anywhere. Okay? Because they just wanted to, the historians and the story of Tukaram. Tukaram also don't mention anywhere. He just mentioned this. This history is also coming from Tukaram Abhangar. So he didn't say anything about his spiritual master or anything. So the story is only given to say that how Vitthala promised the Vishwambar that in your seventh generation the pure devotee will be born. So this history is given. And also this history is given to show that how this Vitthala Rukmini came to Devu from Pandharpur. So these are the two things in the lives of Vishwambar. Okay?
Okay. But Prabhu, just this small question. Then, I mean, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu initiated Vitthala Tukaram. And so Tukaram never glorified Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in his Abhangas.
He mentioned his names, Raghav Chaitanya, Keshav Chaitanya, Sangita Nipuna Maliki. He says that my guru is Raghav Chaitanya, Keshav Chaitanya. And that is how the link is. Yes, but personally, see what happens is Tukaram is in Maharashtra. That's the one difficulty. I'm trying to research on that, what he has to say. But one or two Abhanga he mentions indirectly, not directly. He says, if you know Marathi, he says, that Maja Guru Tha Kaisa Prema Bhava Aponati Deva Hoye Guru. So it means he is Krishna himself, but he has come as my guru out of love for me. And he is giving this mantra, Ramakrishna Hari, which is the Bija Mantra of Hare Krishna Mantra. So he mentions about that. But you see, Tukaram never left Dihu, he never went anywhere. He didn't even go to Vrindavan, he didn't go anywhere. So he didn't even go to, practically probably, he didn't even go to Mayapur, because he just left since the childhood. He stayed in his hometown, Dihu, and just surrounding Pune, that's it. So he never went, just like Haridas Thakur, he never went to Vrindavan. That doesn't mean that he is not a devotee of Krishna, right? So similarly, Tukaram's everything was Pandharpur. So his life is surrounding on Pandharpur and Dehu. Never left beyond that. Okay? There is no mention of Mayapur, or there is no mention of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, other direct mention about this. But we have to understand, Diksha means imbibing the mood of the spiritual master. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mood is Jive Daya Namiruchi Vaishnav Seva. And this you find in Tukaram's life. Jive Daya Namiruchi and Vaishnav Seva. Okay?
Okay. Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Dandavas all goes to Srila Prabhupada. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the very nice class. Prabhu, I had a couple of questions. The first question is there some significance for this seven generations later kind of a theme that devotees are born after seven generations to liberate that lineage or something like that? That is the first question. And the second question I had was about the Harinam that was started in the Pandharpur area. So did it basically begin with Tukaram, or was the Mahamantra already in there before that? And can you explain a little bit about that, Prabhu? How the Harinam
Sanctity? Yes. The first question I will answer, because it is related to today's talk I gave. It is not Narasingdev promises Prahlad Maharaj that your seventh generation will be liberated. It is not like that. So Vishwambar was the, this is from the Tukaram own Abhanga. It says Vishvambar was our Mula Purusha. He is the main person from his family. From that lineage, he remembers because he is the one who brought Vitthal Rukmini. And Vishvambar was promised by those Vitthal Rukmini in your seventh generation. So that is how it is related. There's nothing to do with the seventh generation of family of a devotee is liberated or something like that. Okay, that's the first one. And the second one, I was thinking about talking that tomorrow about that. But
yes,
Tukaram, Tukaram when he got initiated, he is saying that Lord gave me the mantra I like, this Hare Krishna mantra. And as you know, this Hare Krishna mantra is not, even Prabhupada didn't introduce that. This Hare Krishna mantra is Kali Santrana Upanishad at the beginning of the creation. So devotees before Tukaram, they were also going all the way from Maharashtra to all the way to Pandharpur every Ekadashi, and it's like that. It is not that Tukaram started this tradition. It is there even before Tukaram, even before Vishvambar. You see, Vishvambar, when his mother told him to go to Pandharpur, when he came out of Dehu, he saw many people, hundreds of people were, you know, holding this Kataka. And they were playing Mrudanga and Kartal, they were chanting the name of Krishna, and they were going to Pandharpur. So this is not a new tradition that Tukaram started. So this was a tradition since from the beginning of creation that people go to, it's like Jagannath Puri. Nobody, you see all this, nobody knows the history. There is such a long history that this Vedic culture was existed in India. Long time ago. So you cannot say that it started from there. So the beginning of the Hare Krishna mantra is the beginning of the creation, Kali Santrana Upanishad. That's why the Hare Krishna is mentioned. Okay?
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Sorry, sorry.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dhanat Pranam, Yal Glorious Krishna Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much, Prabhuji. I had a very good fortune to read your book also. Very nicely explained about Tukaram. Saint Tukaram. Prabhuji, that he used to chant Pandurika, Pandurika, yes, Lord Vitthala. He used to chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra also.
See, one thing is there about Hare Krishna mantra, like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Nam Namakari Bahuta Nijasarvashak. All names have equal potency. Yes, sometimes he will chant Vitthala, sometimes he will chant Hare Krishna mantra. But he was always telling people to chant Ramakrishna Hari. Now this Ramakrishna Hari, as I told you my lecture also, is also this seed, Bija Mantra of Hare Krishna Mantra. See how many letters are in Hare Krishna Mantra? There are 16. But the Bija is three mantra, Hari, Rama and Krishna. So that is Ramakrishna Hari. So Bhakti Vinod Thakur explains in Chaitanya Upanishad, which is a part of Rig Veda, where he is talking about incarnation of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He said that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will appear to spread this Bija Mantra. Where it is, Hare Krishna mantra is not mentioned. So, it doesn't matter in one sense, but traditionally we see this Hare Krishna mantra is known to everybody. So, even though we don't have a, well, it's 500 years, 400 years since Tukaram. So, he is mentioning Nama Sankirtan, or he is mentioning Ramakrishna Hari, he is mentioning Vitthala. So, similarly, we don't find this full Hare Krishna mantra in Chaitanya Charitamrita or Chaitanya Mangal. Now Krishnadas Kaviraj mentions Harinam, Nama Sankirtan, or Hare Krishna Iti. Because when you write something, this Hare Krishna mantra is 16 words. So all the time you don't write Hare Krishna mantra. So what they write is Harinam. So similarly, Tukaram's Abhangas are, there are hundreds of Abhangas telling about Nama Sankirtan or chanting the name of Krishna. And when he says that, So it obviously means chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, which is the Yuga Dharma. So which is mentioned in Kali Santarana Upanishad. Okay?
Prabhuji, is his birth is mentioned any other any scripts are like yeah, you mentioned in the book also that because his grandfather, I mean his ancestor, he was a pure devotee, and then yeah, he wanted to save his whole line by creating a pure devotee. That was, but is there anywhere his Janma means, is there any prediction, Prabhu? And also I heard, I don't know, I heard that when he saw the dream, he wanted Guru, and he saw the dream. I heard it's Mahaprabhu, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared in his dream, Prabhu?
Yes. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared in his dream, yes.
You are actually not mentioning Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's name, but one Brahman or Shaman or something.
Yes, yes. Yes, one Brahmana appeared. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is that Brahmana. See, one thing is, I don't want it to create any controversy, because only Gaudiya Vaishnavas accept that. Not everybody else in Maharashtra accepts it. So my book was meant for even general people. I don't wanted them to drive away from our philosophy, or I don't wanted them to, just for this reason. I don't want it to. Therefore, I just said Brahmana. But in his Abhanga, it is there. Raghav Chaitanya, Keshav Chaitanya, Sangita Dikuna Malikiji. Okay?
Okay, thank you so much. Because of my daughter, she bought the book that, and I also read. She is okay. Asking, is there any book, Prabhuji? He is again writing, she is asking, Prabhu.
I am writing about Tukaram Abhangas now. If you are Marathi, you see it comes in Marathi magazine every month, Gau Devasya Gava. I have written more than 70 Abhangas till now, and probably soon next year that will also come as a book, Tukaram Abhangas. How Tukaram Abhangas are also, he's talking about Gita and Bhagavat, which what we preach in ISKCON. Okay? It's the same philosophy.
Okay, thank you so much. It's a very sweet Dalavangas. They are very, very sweet. Yeah, thank you, Prabhu, for your everything, whatever you did for.
Hare Krishna. So, thank you all very much. We'll see you tomorrow again in the afternoon. Hare Krishna. Jai Srila Prabhupada.
वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिन्धुभ्यश्च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः. अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय. श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय. हिस्ट्री वृंदावन प्रभु की जय. ऑल ग्लोरीज टू द असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज. थैंक यू ऑल सो मच फॉर जॉइनिंग. हरे कृष्ण. वी विल कंटिन्यू टुमारो. हरे कृष्ण.